Did you know you can get a fudge ton of money and attention on social media just from posting Johnny Depp Amber Heard trial content? The TikTok hashtag Justice for Johnny Depp has over 20 billion views. Your TikTok can go from 200 followers to 200,000 basically overnight. YouTubers have found that while no one cares about their usual content, their trial coverage is in the millions of views. Personally, what I've gained from it is money as well as exposure. One YouTuber said she made $5,000 in 1 week through non-stop trial coverage. Yowza! That's a lot of money and attention, and I love money and attention. Like and subscribe! But like, why did social media push this to the forefront? With all their algorithms and moderators, how did one defamation trial become constant viral content for weeks before they'd even reached a verdict, attracting more attention than any other topic, including the Ukraine war? Mark Zuckerdoodle published this graph, which demonstrates the kind of content social media users engage with the most. This side is cat videos and selfies. This side is stuff I can't name without being demonetized. And this line is the level of engagement. So the closer the content is to breaking the rules, the more scandalous, violent, provocative, the more people engage with it, even if they don't actually like it. And engagement is the main metric social media platforms care about. They want those clicks, they want those reacts and comments, whether it be joy or outrage or laughter. The algorithm will push posts that get the most engagement, the longest watch time. And right now the war in Ukraine is so last month. It's all about the trial of the century. And content creators have learned to play by these rules. During the 2016 US presidential election, people from outside the US were pumping out inflammatory pro-Trump content because it got clicks and consequently those sweet American ad dollars. Others posted the same content, but about Hillary, sometimes with literally just the name swapped out. A custom villain. Whoever you hate most is the bad guy today. It doesn't matter if the content is true. It doesn't matter if it's well written. It just matters that it'll make people feel something, anything, and consequently produce that sweet nectar we call engagement. Mm. The Depp Heard trial has been great for this, and plenty profitable. The Daily Wire, the conservative propaganda machine founded by Ben Shapiro,
wet-ass viewer,
and the second most popular media outlet on Facebook, has paid tens of thousands of dollars to promote their trial coverage on social media. That's a lot of money. But it's a great investment that pays for itself, as well as bringing in new followers. One of their sponsored articles claimed that 2 years ago in the UK defamation trial, Depp was able to disprove 12 of Heard's 14 allegations, but because proving a negative is nearly impossible, the judge in this case branded him a monster and refused to accept his claims. Except that that's not what actually happened. The judge said that more than likely those 12 instances did happen. The Daily Wire just straight up lied about the trial. They corrected it later when they were called out, but not before they got that delicious misinformation out there. And you know what? That's a great business investment. Over 90% of online users engaging with the trial content were on Depp's side, and anyone posting pro-Heard content was getting tons of harassment. If you're after clicks and followers in a trial where taking one side will get you money and attention and taking the other side will get you doxxed and harassed, it's very easy to see which side is the better for your business. Never mind waiting for the trial to actually reach a verdict. The Daily Wire and the conservative media ecosystem around it have been trying to push back against the Me Too movement for years. And this has been a great opportunity. But does social media really allow for misinformation? Don't they have precautions against that? Especially when someone's paying to show it to millions of people. During his 2016 election campaign, Trump worked with Cambridge Analytica, a British political consulting firm which used social media to acquire information about voters.
We have somewhere close to 4,000 or 5,000 data points we can use to predict the personality of every adult in the United States.
It is a full-service propaganda machine.
You know those permissions windows you had to approve of when you used an app or a quiz through Facebook? In this case, they gave Cambridge Analytica permission to access not only your information, but also the info of all your friends. This is the data Cambridge Analytica used to help Trump on his 2016 election campaign. The data helped them identify undecided voters, which they then targeted with personalized misinformation ads in favor of Trump. Is your aunt struggling to find a job? Then they'll show her an ad about how immigrants are coming to steal American jobs and how Trump will build a wall to keep them out.
We bombarded them through blogs, websites, articles, videos, ads, every platform you can imagine, until they saw the world the way we wanted them to, until they voted for our candidate.
Cambridge Analytica also boasted about helping secure Brexit and working on 200 other political campaigns around the world, which they claimed they all won.
We just put information into the bloodstream, the internet,
and then watch it grow. It has to happen without anyone thinking that's propaganda.
One of the campaigns they worked on via their parent company was the 2016 presidential election in the Philippines. Rodrigo Duterte is a populist whose image was rebranded for the election into a tough, no-nonsense man of action, known for his outrageous statements and his war on crime, which in his previous position as a mayor included death squads executing over 1,000 people. His popularity was fueled by internet misinformation about terrorism and drug addicts. He was massively popular on social media and won by a landslide. But misinformation isn't always planned and strategic. There are these content farms which put out a ton of content about celebrity gossips and scandals and cat videos, building up a following, sometimes up to millions of followers, and then during moments of political crisis, such as an election or the pandemic, suddenly trade out their cute cat content for a lot of very clickable misinformation to those millions of people. During the Philippines election campaign, a content farm called Twin Mark Media suddenly shifted from covering celeb scandals to promoting Rodrigo Duterte. At first, people thought the company was paid to make this content, but they admitted that they made this decision on their own because they found it just brought in the most engagement. During the Myanmar coup, people such as researcher Victoire Rio used Facebook live videos to keep track of their loved ones to make sure they were okay. Rio was watching a live video of what was happening in Myanmar when she realized she had seen this video before. She discovered that many of these live videos from Myanmar weren't live at all. They were reused footage and weren't even being streamed from Myanmar, but from Vietnam and Cambodia. She uncovered massive private groups sharing tools for generating fake Facebook accounts and streaming fake live content, and advice on how to find viral content in different countries and convert it into clickbait articles, including propaganda and lies about what was happening in Myanmar. The thing is, these clickbaiters probably weren't trying to amplify misinformation and weren't politically motivated. They don't care about presidential elections and coups and all that bollocks. They just uncovered an effective way to make good money off a trending topic. TikTok has similarly been promoting fake content about the war in Ukraine. Many of the most popular videos on the platform included footage that was doctored or old or from a completely different country, or even literally video game footage. Not only is it disgusting that they were using this tragedy for profit, this sort of misinformation is also genuinely dangerous for people trying to figure out what's happening on the ground, including for people in that area. Viral misinformation can have real consequences. The United Nations determined that Facebook directly influenced the genocide of 10,000 Myanmar Muslim Rohingya people from 2016 to 2017. A few years before, Myanmar was beginning to liberalize and open up the telecommunications market, allowing for a wide adoption of mobile internet, which Silicon Valley immediately used as an opportunity to expand their business. Myanmar military and nationalist Buddhist monks used the newly popular Facebook for a massive campaign of spreading misinformation and stoking hatred against the Rohingya minority. Rohingya Muslims have been persecuted in Myanmar since the 1970s, and soon anti-Muslim messages and lies were all over Facebook, now able to spread much faster and more effectively. The military spread rumors of upcoming civil attacks to put the country on edge and make people trust the army, whose actions ended up with villages burned to the ground, 10,000 dead, and 700,000 refugees. And Facebook knew about this. Early on, they were warned by a journalist working in Myanmar who flew to Facebook's California headquarters to warn the executives, and they basically chose to ignore it. After a UN investigation found that Facebook played a determining role in what happened, Facebook gave a lukewarm admission and promised to do better. They said they want to curb misinformation. It's just really hard because the machines are so complicated and there's so much data. But actually, Facebook has already developed pretty effective tools for tracking misinformation. They're just not using them. Every new algorithm that Facebook comes up with is tested on a small pool of users to see how it works, and primarily, how it affects engagement. If the engagement is down too much, the algorithm is shelved. And since we know that borderline content, including misinformation, is what incites the most engagement, algorithms that would prevent the spread of such posts don't really stand a chance. Facebook is a free service, as is Instagram and pretty much all social media. We don't need to pay to have an account. And we get a lot of bang for $0. They host all our photos and videos. They keep decades of messages to our friends and family, all free of charge. So they gotta make money somehow. So they use advertising. But actually, internet ads aren't all that profitable. You make like 0.01 pennies per click, and most people never even click ads. It's a pretty small profit margin. Facebook is estimated to only make about $8 a year per user, depending on where you live. So like your Facebook account is only worth like 8-10 bucks a year to them. To make money from online ads, they have to make sure people spend as much time as possible on the platform to maximize their exposure to them. Algorithms are tweaked to present you with the most enticing, enraging, the most clickable content. It also helps that everything about social media is carefully designed to be as addictive as humanly possible. To keep you emotionally engaged, algorithms also show you increasingly extreme content. They can measure what side of an issue you stand on, whether it's politics or sport or conspiracy theories, and they will show you not only exclusively the side you agree with, but actually take you even deeper down the rabbit hole. Facebook developers have done several studies that proved very clearly that their platform is measurably radicalizing people and changing their opinions. But they're not stopping it, because changing the polarizing algorithm would be anti-growth. Just like content farms, social media platforms don't necessarily want to spread inflammatory content and lies. That just happens to be an unfortunate side effect of making loads and loads of moolah. Ads are also the reason why Facebook, Google, and other tech giants want to know so much about you. The more they know about you, the more hope they have of showing you an ad you might actually click. That's why firms such as Cambridge Analytica get to exploit our data.
Data is the most valuable asset on Earth. The reason why these companies are the most powerful companies in the world is because last year data surpassed oil in its value.
Since the profit per user is so low, they have to make sure they have as many users as possible. Those measly 8 bucks per user add up when you have nearly 3 billion users. Last year, Facebook/Meta's overall revenue was $117 billion. One of the reasons why so many of the misinformation tragedies we've mentioned happened in the Global South is because Facebook and other American tech giants have been aggressively pushing for growth there, especially since Facebook is plateauing in the West. New Americans and Europeans don't want to sign up for your service? That's fine. There are a lot of places in the world that don't even have full internet coverage yet, and if you give them internet, you can make sure they become new customers. Facebook has developed several Global South projects where they partner with local phone providers to offer people free but limited access to the internet, which means they get, for example, full access to Facebook while the rest of the web is text only. They're trying to pass this off as charity, but for example, in India, local tech bros have called it poor internet for poor people, and the government ended up basically outlawing it. In other countries, it's been more effective. For example, in the Philippines, nearly 100% of internet users are also Facebook users. Facebook ends up controlling the front page of the internet. Filipino journalist Maria Ressa, who won the Nobel Peace Prize for her coverage of Filipino President Rodrigo Duterte, used to see Duterte as the main problem, but now she has turned her fight against Facebook. She says that Facebook's consistent failure to combat misinformation and hate speech poses an existential threat to democracy.
Facebook is the world's largest distributor of news, and yet studies have shown that lies laced with anger and hate spread faster and further than facts. These American companies controlling our global information ecosystem are biased against facts, biased against journalists. They are by design dividing us and radicalizing us.
Both Google and Facebook are currently in the process of building massive undersea cables, literally around the whole of Africa, in a race to bring the continent better internet coverage. If Facebook can harvest enough data to swing an election just from its platform users, imagine how much valuable data they can gather when literally every move you make online is traveling through their cables, and when their infrastructure carries entire countries' health, governance, and security data. Silicon Valley is operating on the neo-colonial assumption that high-speed internet access is a civilizing force and that their products are universal to the whole world. They also prioritize rapid growth and don't want to be slowed down by opening local offices and considering how what is basically an entirely new way of engaging with the world will develop in local environments. All they see is new users. In 15 years, Africa will be 20% of the world population. Now's the time to really make a big bet. Facebook whistleblower Francis Haugen said that one of Facebook's biggest problems is the lack of support for non-English languages. If Facebook's doing a dodgy job of stopping hate and misinformation in English, You can imagine what's happening in languages Facebook doesn't understand.
I knew I could never live with myself if I watched, you know, 10 million, 20 million people over the next 20 years die because of violence that was facilitated by social media.
One of the reasons Haugen came forward was because she saw firsthand how social media is not going to regulate itself and curb the spread of misinformation on its own. Not only would it affect their engagement and thus bottom line, they're also very worried about their reputation and about seeming fair. You see, Facebook, Google, and other tech giants have faced accusations that their platforms allow discrimination against minorities. For example, job ads sometimes aren't shown to women or to people who haven't specified their gender. Facebook was accused of housing discrimination in the US for allowing property ads that weren't shown to Black, Jewish, Muslim, or disabled users. But we mustn't forget the most oppressed minority in the United States. Conservatives have claimed that there's an anti-conservative bias on social media, and that scared the shit out of Zucky Baby because he wants to please his conservative users too. So to address all these issues at once, Facebook established the Responsible AI team, whose job is to make sure the algorithms aren't fucking anyone over. The problem is that when a new algorithm, let's say for preventing medical misinformation, was tested, it turned out it affected conservative users more than the progressive ones. Mind, progressives are also posting misinformation, but conservatives are posting it a lot more often. And because of this discrepancy, a misinformation preventing algorithm would affect conservatives more than progressives, which is deemed unfair AI. And so the misinformation busting algorithm isn't allowed to be implemented. Finally, equality. To avoid accusations of anti-conservative bias, Facebook also fired the humans who wrote the trending topics description and replaced them with robots. Less than 2 days later, misinformation was trending on the list. Even when these companies set out to do good, they can't tame the beast they've created. Zucky Wucky was determined to use Facebook to help people access accurate information about COVID and encourage vaccination, but because of the way the platform is designed, it instead ended up being flooded with conspiracy theories and proven falsehoods that put people's lives on the line. Leaked documents showed that Facebook is acutely aware of this, that even when trying to make sure people are seeing vetted information from reliable sources in order to save lives, the misinformation-hungry algorithm still wins. So we find ourselves in a predicament where a huge percentage of people are relying on social media as a source of news and information, and the social media platforms are spreading inflammatory, untrue content because as long as it's sensational enough, that's what will help them grow. And this isn't just Facebook. We talk a lot about Facebook in this video because they've been around for so long and there's been a lot of research and a lot of whistleblowers, but the exact same principles apply to all social media networks. Experts have suggested that visual content can actually be even more convincing. And platforms like TikTok, Instagram, Twitch, and YouTube are built on visual content. Am I convincing? The largest donor to the Brexit campaign said, "Facts don't work and won't bring you victory." And he's right. Research shows that people don't change their minds because of facts. We change them because we're engaged emotionally. And angry posts spread much faster and farther than joyful ones. And of course, politicians lied to people before the internet, but they never had a tool to spread propaganda so fast and cheap and to manipulate us on an individual, personalized level. We also know that social media can manipulate our emotions. Facebook conducted a study of 689,000 users who, by the way, were not informed about this, and in the study they proved they could control how people felt by manipulating the kind of content they were shown. If we're guided by emotions, not by fact, and if these platforms can change our emotions with the click of a button, while also letting emotionally manipulative misinformation spread en masse, that has some pretty damning implications for politics and media and, you know, the concept of democracy.
Parliament spent 18 months investigating. Their report says very clearly, our electoral laws are not fit for purpose. We literally cannot have a free and fair election in this country because of the tech giants who are still completely unaccountable.
In fact, some experts and commentators have suggested social media has changed the fabric of our society so much that we don't actually live under democracy or capitalism anymore, but under techno-feudalism or corporate autocracy.
One person owns the whole digital space. Imagine you step out in Ljubljana, on the streets of Ljubljana today, and you look around and you think, oh my God, all these buildings belong to one person. Everything that is traded in the shops that I see is controlled by one person who decides what prices are charged? What prices are not charged? Who can trade? Who can't trade? Who can buy? Who can't buy? And moreover, imagine that Ljubljana operated like Facebook does or Amazon does, whereby what your eyes see is determined by one person, by the algorithm of one person, who, if he wants you not to see something, you will never see it in that digital space. This is not a market. This is a fiefdom.
I am a kind of citizen of these places. I exist there. I, you know, like I have a lot of social relationships in those spaces. I also have a business in those spaces. And so in many ways, like I am a citizen of YouTube, but I certainly don't get a vote.
We're left with a system where it's up to individual users to spot misinformation. And we're just not good at that. How could we be? Even experts are limited to their own expertise. You can't be an expert on everything. Regardless of your politics, your age, or your preferred data stealing platform, Zoomers aren't smarter than boomers. We're all being served lies all day long, and we all think we know better than everyone else. Researchers have also suggested that our common sense approach of critical thinking and doing your research actually makes people more susceptible to misinformation, not less. Part of this is that misinformation wants your attention. So to scrutinize it is to do exactly what it wants. Give it a chance to convince you. And you may think, well, I do my research. But research is often skewed heavily by filter bubbles. Filter bubbles are the result of algorithms trying to engage you by presenting you with the content they think that you will like. If a social media or Google algorithm has decided you believe a certain conspiracy theory or have taken a side on an issue, that's the sort of content they'll present you with. Humans already have a confirmation bias, making us more prone to believe information that fits with our existing beliefs and dismiss anything that opposes them. And it's even harder to do your research when Google and TikTok are only going to show you more of what you want to see. Johnny Depp probably has a parasocial relationship with like every English-speaking human being on the planet. For many of us since childhood, he is such a staple of our culture that for him to be guilty would spoil the works of Tim Burton, the Pirates of the Caribbean films, Harry Potter, as if that couldn't get any worse, all the stuff we loved as kids and the stuff that our kids love now. When Johnny Depp's attorneys asked the judge to allow the cameras into the courtroom in a state famous for litigation tourism, they knew exactly what they were doing. Insider reported that someone close to Depp said, "I think for him it was let the public, let the jury, let the judge see everything, the good, the bad, the ugly, and let them decide who's telling the truth here and who's not." Oh right, because of course a trial is all about letting the public decide who is innocent. Which narrative would you prefer? Your childhood hero is a villain or your childhood hero is a hero? That you were wrong about this or that you were right? I know which I'd prefer to be the truth. I know which content I'd prefer to engage with on social media. And if social media can figure out which content you'd prefer to engage with, you're gonna get it. As the trial was live streamed on YouTube, Johnny Depp's team was utilizing social media to convince people of his innocence before the trial had even really begun, with a jury that was not sequestered and who probably have seen at least one or two Johnny Depp movies in which he's the hero. Or Captain Jack Sparrow. Sometimes even alcoholism can be cute. So even if Depp were, hypothetically speaking, guilty, I can very much imagine social media heavily promoting the idea of his innocence during the trial. Whatever choices the algorithm makes, they will be radical and encourage a passionate response. Whether he's guilty or innocent, in every timeline, Johnny Depp wins social media. But naturally, the jury were told not to read about the case online, so it shouldn't matter. I mean, we wouldn't want them to be swayed by public opinion, right? Except they were allowed to keep their phones, and after the trial each day, they were going home to their families, who probably were on social media, even if the jurors weren't. Would it have even been possible for them to avoid it? They must have been doing something at home because apparently some of them were falling asleep during the trial. An anonymous juror has now said, "Social media did not impact us. We followed the evidence. We didn't take into account anything outside the courtroom," which is not the same thing as saying you didn't look at social media or that you didn't discuss it with anyone who did. Being influenced by social media isn't a conscious choice, nor is living in a society heavily influenced by it.
We just put information into the bloodstream, to the internet. It has to happen without anyone thinking that's propaganda.
With legacy media, newspapers, news channels, there are journalistic standards that need to be adhered to. YouTubers and Instagrammers and TikTokers and twatters don't have to worry about all that. And you will trust them more, because they will feel more authentic and personable. And through all this, there's been a financial incentive encouraged by the broken dystopian algorithms of social media. We're seeing people see entertainment in the trial, content creators saying, you know what? This is how I actually can build my brand. It's a memification of domestic violence. Conservative misogynists reacting to the Me Too movement have rallied behind Depp and used and abused social media to promote the meme of his innocence while profiting off of it and gaining new followers. And all of this is consistent with what we've seen of social media before, the grim, greedy system which puts profit before people. And at the end of the day, we know that minds are not easily changed by facts. Even if the jury was given all the facts, if they were at all emotionally impacted by the hyper-influence of the social media mania, their opinions may easily have been swayed. Maybe Depp is innocent. I don't know. Maybe the UK court was wrong and the unsequestered American jury, who were mostly male, going home with their phones at night and falling asleep during the trial, were right. But whether or not he is innocent, this was a wildly unethical way to bring justice, which has empowered many of the wrong people and set a frightening precedent. If he is innocent and truly the victim here, I find it pretty upsetting to see the joy he's now experiencing from the harm he's done in this trial, the complete lack of awareness this alleged victim has of the damage he's done to other victims of domestic violence. Johnny Depp's already got his next film deal. Plenty of people have already made their profit from social media, and it's all over now, except it's not over at all. This is the world we live in, and this is the kind of future we can expect our kids to grow into. It feels a little bit hopeless. But there are steps we can take to change the social media landscape and our own behavior too. Facebook shows you toxic content and steals your data for only 10 bucks a year. Could I just pay 10 bucks a year instead? If Facebook isn't worried about stealing my data and increasing my engagement because they're already getting money directly from my pocket, they can stop prioritizing outrageous content and ideally stop manipulating my emotions altogether and let me just enjoy the social part of social media. Ethan Zuckerman called the ad-based model of making money online internet's original sin. But the internet doesn't have to be ad-driven. The platforms we use could be supported by memberships. They could be non-profit and paid for by grants and donations like Wikipedia. They could be open source and self-hosted. Your own private Twitter with your rules just for you and your besties, or an LGBT Twitter just for the local community. There is open source software similar to sites like Twitter. You'd just have to pay to host it. I think that'd be a really neat thing to do for local communities. We could revive the culture of weird and wonderful personal websites. I think I remember how to code HTML. I could do that. It's not that hard. Reshaping the internet like this would break up these massive global monopolies. You know, Zuckerberg's insistence that he doesn't want to be the arbiter of truth is understandable, but whether or not he wants it, he has that power. And the answer is not to do nothing with it, it's to take it away and break up these platforms. The internet needs to be decentralized. Luckily, the EU and even the US are starting to push back with legislation to tame these tech companies. The EU is cracking down on fake news and hate speech, and the US is finally starting to realize that maybe some of these monopolies are slightly illegal. As for what you can do to help yourself avoid misinformation, misinformation researcher Michael Caulfield has devised an alternative approach called SIFT. S means stop. Social media is very good at convincing us to make quick calls on issues we know very little about. You have a couple of seconds to decide whether you agree with a post, whether you'll like it and share it, but you don't have to do that. Saying, actually, I don't know enough about this to make a call is a much safer and healthier bet. I stands for investigate the source. Who posted this? What is their stake in this? What's their reliability track record? F stands for find better sources. Go and see what the experts in the field are saying. What's the consensus? And what are the big reliable outlets or figures' takes on this? If they're not even covering it, it probably didn't happen. If they don't have a consensus yet, wait. And finally, T is for trace claims to their original source. Are the photos and videos really depicting what they're claiming to? Have they been taken out of context or changed or manipulated somehow? If you're not willing to go through this process and really devote some time to it with an open mind, just stop at the first step. You don't have to make this call. You don't have to make a choice right now. You don't have to engage with every exciting clickbait you see. I also believe we need to create a culture of citing reputable sources. So in whatever way you can, we put citations up here in the corner, just try to encourage this culture of citations, not just because they show others where you got the info, but also because they encourage you to work harder to be correct about something. And we find they help us to recognize how easy it is to misremember and be wrong about something. And definitely keeps me humble. I'm wrong a lot. The world just needs to slow down. The internet gives us too much, too fast, all at once. Sometimes I just feel like I have to somehow process every one of the world's problems every day, and it all just seems hopeless. But then again, I spend a good amount of time on social media. We can't rely on social media as it is to shape our worldview. The way we communicate is part of what makes us human, and the potential of social media is incredible. But we're still learning to understand this new internet culture, and mistakes are going to be made, and greedy people are going to try to exploit that. But things can change if we don't let them pull the wool over our eyes. There is a utopian version of all this. We just need a bit of course correction. Thank you for watching, and thank you so much to all my patrons for your support. And a special thanks to Eric Parkinson, Angela, Chris Endicott, Corwin Found, Fluffy Bunny Boo, Gamer Guy J, Gwenda Euphoria, Helena Varvarousis, Infinite Waterfall, Joe Liss, Juliana Backer, Machina X Domina, Mia Nilo, Mathete, Non Anonymous, Siobhan, Stephen Wallace, Tasha Heim, Wix, Abigail Eckstein, Erin, Alice, Alice Lovell, Alina Vera, Amelia D, Anya Stephen, Anna S, Apathetic Gaiety, Arden, Artemix, Avery, Avriotta, B, Ben Hengst, Beslaf, Beth, Beth Hershey, By Ronnie, Break Every Yoke, Bump Girl, Kane Friedman, Katrina Lexi, Charis Edwards, Chloe Strange, Claire, Comfort and Adam, Connor Thompson, Deanna McMillan, Dorothy, Dropout Ninja, Eden Ladley, Erie Enby, Ellie Cannard, Elsie Astro, Emery James Fairgrieve, Evergarden Wall, Fafa Alania, Fancy Angles, Felixer of Life, Gabriella Day, Gavin Salmon, Gerard Brenter, Ghosts and You Might Die, Ginger, Grace Robertson, Grisala Farben, Hackneyed Edits, Hilda Mangold, Hope Writes, Jackie Quing of Thieves, Jam Kwasowski, Jennifer Fronister, Jessage, Gillian D, Joit, Joe McManus, Jules Inkwell, Julio Mendez, Julius Sarwin, Juniper Lopez, Cafe Mewtwo, Kale, Kate and Jess, Katie B, Katie Bollinger, Katya, Kate Sarah, Kaylani Garcia, Kelly Flynn, Kisa, Kyle Denley, Lacey Cox, Lee Headstrom, Lindsay Mercer, Lisa Spitalovitz, Lumpy Llama, Malva, Marla, Math Class Warfare, McKenning Wood, Mike Bucket, Miss Mad, Mizaki Demazan, Mugsy, Moshe Gordon Radian, Mrunmai Salil, Mirren McGlynn, Neve, Nico, Nick Snary, Nina, Noe, Ossian Matthew, Pani Lin, Pseudo Pac-Man, Queer Aesthetic, Radical Planning, Rebecca Peacock, River Haddocock, Rock the Shell, Sabrina Ehrensberger, Sarah R, Sawyer Donk, Shoxtopia, Shaped Headed By, Sean, She Algorithm, Simon Patience, Sithvich, Soy, Straw Fox, Summertime Killer, Susie S, Sveeple the Trans Boy Valkyrie, Taya Quinn, The Children of Jack Acid, Thomas O'Shagan Halajan, Tia Till, Tina Gigya, Tom Harrison, Troy Zaire, Verlux, Vicious Panda, Vince Whitaker, Wandering Sock, Wards, Will O'Connor, Jonathan Zunger, and Yuli Themstedt. Thank you all so much, I really appreciate it.